And Juno, well, that's the least that I know. I'm sure he's involved in many other activities. And I've had the pleasure of listening to his talks in the recent past. It's a pleasure to invite you, Professor Ranucci, and you can please start your talk.
Thanks a lot. Yes, I am involved in that two experiment, and it's already enough. I was also involved in some other experiments, but in the past. So maybe I will shut down the video because otherwise the bandwidth occupation might be too much. Sorry for this, but it's better. And thank you for the kind invitation to speak about the very recent result of the Borexino experiment concerning the first detection ever of a solar neutrino coming from the CNO cycle. The Borexino collaboration has announced this result a few months ago, and just recently we have published on Nature our findings. So I am very happy to give here some detail on this. Okay, let me introduce briefly the detector, just to give you a context for the research that I am describing. Borexino, first of all, is located underground at the Gran Sasso Laboratory, so with about 3,800 meters of rock shielding in terms of water equivalent. It is a very simple geometry, like most of the large volume Lewis scintillators still presently ongoing. So internally there is a balloon that you can appreciate in blue in this cartoon, which contain the Lewis scintillator, about 200 tons. The Lewis scintillator is fundamentally an hydrocarbon, so it's very similar to gasoline, fundamentally. Doped with a dopant who gives the hydrocarbon the property to create lights upon detection of an incoming neutrino or any other particles. Outside the core of the detector, there is an inner buffer which ensure the zero buoyancy across the wall of the balloon containing the scintillator. So this balloon you can see like a sort of big Montgolfier, and they are two, one inside another. And all is enclosed in a stainless steel sphere, which acts also to support for the multipliers which detect the light. In fact, the detection principle is scattering of incoming neutrinos on the electron of the scintillator, production of light. The light propagate to the spheres and is detected by these big electronic eyes. We need other shielding, and so we have another outside container, a big water tank, which contain shielding water, which mainly protect us against neutron gammas from the surrounding rock, from the activity in the surrounding rock of Gran Sasso. The threshold is rather low, about 60 keV in terms of energy of a scattered electron, and the data taking now is an old story, is an old business. We started in May 2007, and by the way, we are very close to the end of the lifetime of the experiment. So in the end, we will have accumulated more than 14 years of data. The collaboration comprises groups from several countries and continents. So we have a group from US, a group from France, from Italy, from Germany, from Poland and from Russia. In order to set also the context in theoretical term, let me remind that for what concern the prediction of a solar neutrino flux at Earth, this is a long story which started when the solar neutrino investigation commenced. So more at this point, more than 40 years ago, almost 50 years ago. It was a long saga, both theoretical and experimental. In this sense, Borezino is the last actor of this long and successful saga. The prediction of neutrinos from the sun relies on a standard solar model, which have been developed by John Bacall mainly during all these decades and followed by some of his collaborators. And the standard solar model is based on the two mechanisms which are supposed to exist in the core of the sun to produce energy. And these two mechanisms were initially hypothesized by Bethe von Weizsäcker in the 1938. And one is based on proton-proton fusion, so it's a PP, this is the so-called PP chain, which is reported in the right, in the left part of this slide. And this chain has several points in which nuclear reactions produce neutrinos, five, they are indicated in the plot. On the other hand, we have the Cyrano cycle, in which instead the proton fusion to helium is catalyzed by heavy metal, so fundamentally carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. So in both cases, the output of the mechanism is the same. So helium produced from hydrogen, but the mechanism is different. Which of the two mechanisms is dominant depends on the mass of the star. We know that for a star massive at the level of the sun, most of energy is produced by the PP chain, while the Cyrano cycle is dominant in massive star. And this is of importance to prove it also in the sun itself. The prediction of solar neutrino fluxes coming from this model are, for example, recently updated in the paper which I reported here, and overall, take into account for the PP chain all the previous measurements, including the measurement that was also done by Borezino until 2018, plus the other neutrino experiment, there is a very good agreement between the prediction and the result. What we have done now, what I am focusing today, is instead in the first reaction, in the first observation of the elusive neutrinos, very few coming from the CNO cycle. Let me simply remind for completeness that the standard model, standard solar model story is not yet ended because an ingredient, so the metallicity, the content of heavy metal on the surface of the sun is still a controversial item. And so in reality, there are two variants of the model and solar neutrinos can help, and this is also part of what we are still doing in the last months of the experiment, can help to understand which of the two variants is correct because the metallicity composition impacts the amount of Cyrano flux. For what concern the measurement, so this is essentially a talk which is given by an experimentalist, so I am focused on the experimental part of the story. I had to start with the PP chain investigation, which fundamentally is at the basis of the quest for the CNO. So how we measured the PP neutrinos and how we extended our investigation of PP neutrinos to catch also the CNO neutrinos. Well, what we did is something that is very, very common in experimental nuclear measurement. We made the spectrum, a spectrum of events. In particular, we made the spectrum of electrons scattered by the neutrinos coming from the sun. And once we have accumulated this spectrum, which in this picture is represented by the blue, by the black scattered point, we have fitted this spectrum to a model in which we put together the signal component and the background component. This is a straightforward approach. which is made possible because Borexino is extremely pure in terms of radioactive in thermal contaminants. So the background model that we can put inside the spectral filter is composed by components which are limited in amount. Because obviously, if the background would be extremely high, we would be completely masked by the background, and there would be no way, even through a filter, to extract the signal. The latest measurement of the full PP chain, so you see the fluxes, the PP fluxes, beryllium 7, PP and boron 8, the four of fluxes all coming from the PP chain, was measured in 2018 and gave us as byproduct also an upper limit for the CNO. The fit was a special multivariate fit based on a Monte Carlo modeling of a detector. From this fit, we understood why the measurement, the detection of the CNO in the mid of this spectrum was difficult. First of all, because the rate is low. So also the PP fluxes are very low, but the CNO, given only a modest fraction of the CNO component, of a solar flux component is very low. It's a continuous spectrum. You see from the red spectrum here indicated with the CNO arrow. So it's a featureless spectrum. Like a normal beta spectrum without any edge like the beryllium 7 or the PP, which instead are very, very characteristic, and is in a strong correlation with other two components that we found in this global experimental spectrum. The component from the PAP fusion in the PP chain, which sit just in the same energy region, but this can be somehow taken into account, and a background, which is the only residual background important coming from internal radioactivity, important for the CNO quest, which is the bismuth 210 background. I will speak more about this background. Here I have listed some of the result of Borexino pre-CNO, so the summa of our previous PP results. Okay, now the CNO correlation with the PAP and the bismuth has been recognized. I have summarized here in a few words, but really this was the output of many years of studies, was identified by us experimentally as very hurdle this type of correlation to disentangle, to single out the CNO signal. So in this plot, I have removed all the other components and I have left only the components which are members of this correlation. So the red spectrum is the soft CNO spectrum, the green spectrum is the bismuth 210 background spectrum. The blue is the PAP solar neutrino spectrum. Okay, here I have put an insert with the purity of Borexino, just to give an idea of what kind of purity we deal to perform a solar neutrino investigation. So we have at the level of concentration, the liquid scintill level of uranium and thorium naturally occurring at the level of 10 to minus 19 gram per gram. I remind that in normal construction material everywhere on the surface of Earth, this concentration is there when are good are at the level of 10 to minus 9, 10 to minus 10. So we are about 10 order of magnitude better than the good radio purity that can be found in constructive material. So this gives the idea.
Giacino?
Yes?
I think maybe the slide is frozen. Have you moved on to the slide after the spectrum? Somehow we can't see it.
You see, I am now in slide 8. You see it?
No. Oh, so
okay, I reshare the screen. One moment.
Yeah.
Okay, now I am in the 7. Okay?
Yeah, it says, yeah, perfect.
Okay. And this is 6. So I resume from 7. The message in the slide 6 was that, unfortunately, you didn't see, but I can summarize that the radiopurity of the experiment is extremely good, much better than any possible radiopurity on the Earth. The second message is that the only residual background in the uranium chain is the bismuth-210. The third message is that it's true that I have another component which is affecting this measurement, which is the PEP neutrino spectrum. But from theoretical consideration and from the previous measurement of other experiments and of Brixium itself, I can constrain the PEP component to a very precise level at the order of 1.4%. And this means that in my quest, in our quest for the bismuth, the only important background that I have to deal with is the bismuth-210 spectrum. This bismuth-210, what is a member of the uranium chain. In particular, is a member that's coming toward the end of the uranium secular chain. It is originated by lead-210. And it is followed after a few days by polonium-210. So it's really an isotope whose lifetime is very short. And in general, would have been not important because of its short lifetime. But the problem is that there is a source inside the detector which feed it continuously. And the source is this lead-210, which instead lives 32 years, which is sitting on the vessel of the detector itself. However, the bismuth-212 per se would be easily identifiable because it is connected with the polonium-210. The polonium-210 is an alpha component. In our analysis, is not a problem because it can be easily tagged due to the partial discrimination properties of the Lewis scintillator. So in an ideal world, I could say, okay, I am left only with the bismuth-210 background, but I can easily subtract it and remain only with the CMO signal because I can pinpoint the bismuth background by identifying the polonium-210 background, mainly because of the Paschet discrimination. So in the end, this means that the quest for the CNO is turned into a quest of the bismuth-212 through the polonium-212. But unfortunately, reality is never so simple. And in fact, this very difficult experimental story to catch the CNO neutrino in the Lewis scintillator Borexino, which in principle can be expressed in few words, a fit of the record spectrum. In reality, became a very long saga, which lasted almost 7 years. We started in 2014 to focus on the CNO measurement for a specific reason, because we noticed that the lead-210, 32 years lifetime long, which produces the polonium, the bismuth-210, is also sitting on the inner vessel of the scintillator. Why? Probably, obviously, we are speaking of contamination, which are incredibly low. As I showed before, we are many, many order of magnitude purer than any other material on the face of Earth. But even these thin contamination are important when one wants to get this small number of solar neutrino events in our liquid scintillator. Well, Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, then what we noticed is that for some reason during the construction or during the first filling with water of the detector, some lead 210 was left over the surface of the inner vessel. And from the surface of the inner vessel, since the scintillator as any liquid under thermal not stable condition moves for convective motion, then from the surface of the vessel was this polonium, this lead 210 was moving inside the surface, the core of the scintillator, producing an extra component of polonium 210, which at this point become relevant for the identification of the bismuth, in the sense that the bismuth to which we are interested is the bismuth in the liquid scintillator, which is in equilibrium with the polonium in the liquid scintillator only. But if there is an additional component coming from the surface, then this additional component perturbs this equilibrium, and I cannot anymore use the polonium inside the scintillator as a proxy, as a measurement of the bismuth inside the scintillator. So without taking compensating measure, this convection effect is dominant, and I cannot infer my desired intrinsic bismuth level, and therefore I cannot subtract it to get the CNO. So step by step, the problem for the CNO were first reduced experimentally to a problem to identify the bismuth. The problem to identify the bismuth was reduced, transformed into the problem to identify the associated polonium 210 associated to the bismuth 210. And then it is transformed to identify only the relevant polonium, removing the extra component coming from the surface vessel. So a reduction of the problem to the very last essence, which means to stop the convective motion, which is responsible of this bringing of additional polonium 210 from the surface to the core of the liquid scintillator. We had several examples of this effect, of this movement of isotopes inside the liquid. I do not go into the details, because clearly, in order to understand what's happening inside the detector took many, many, many years of observation, observing the polonium distribution and observing the temperature distribution across the detector itself. So, for example, here there is an event that we noticed at a certain point in 2013. We noticed that a sudden change of temperature, which is the sharp drop on the top plot, produced a sudden variation of decay of the polonium 210, which is represented by the curve on the bottom. So the investigation of the effect was long, the understanding was not immediate. It required many probes to understand what's happening inside the detector. When, in any case, we understood that the origin of the problem for the CNO detection was linked to the fact that the liquid was not perfectly still, and that the convective motion had to be stopped as prerequisite for this measurement, well, then we embarked since 2014 in a sort of a second refurbishment of the detector. The first refurbishment was a purification campaign that we held in 2010. So 4 years after the purification campaign, we decided to refurbish completely the detector by wrapping externally with an insulation layer in order to decouple the inside and the outside of the detector, since we all see of Gran Sasso where the detector is sitting, is subjected to many temperature variation unavoidably. Then we deployed in 54 position in the detector very precise temperature probes in order to monitor exactly the temperature variation of the detector. And third, we devised tested a complex fluid dynamical simulation. For this, we were helped by our colleagues of a Polytechnic Engineering School of Milano. And all this effort produced in the end the fact that we are in condition to predict exactly the thermal behavior of a detector by contrasting, as in the third plot here, the output of a flow dynamical simulation with the output of the probes. On top of this, very recently, so in 2019, we even decided to stabilize the temperature of the whole sea. So in total, there has been an enduring effort which has lasted for more than 6 years to understand some press and model the temperature variation in the detector. This is just an example, more detailed of how the detector was wrapped, taking into account that the inset that you see here of the external water tank wrapped with the insulating material is a setup which is 20 meter high, which goes from the bottom to the top of the OC. So all the entire hall in is 8 is occupied by the Borizino tank. And this gives an idea of the very refined understanding that we got of the internal temperature of the detector by deploying all these probes through several positions in the detector. So the effort was really very, in a certain sense, was very invasive. So it was really a second refurbishment of the detector. However, to ensure that the liquid was as still as possible, so in order not to have any sizable residual convective motion inside, was important not only to have a full isolation, but also to have a stable top-bottom gradient. This is key to ensure for a liquid static condition. In Gran Sasso, has been possible because the rock temperature on the bottom is naturally held by the water flowing around at underground at 7 degrees. So in order to have a stable top-bottom gradient, we decided to anchor artificially the bottom, the top temperature with an active temperature control system, which is simply done by some serpentines in which there is a flow of water with controlled temperature. In this way, we artificially established this top-bottom gradient temperature. And this is an example, this is part of the refurbishment of the detector, of this serpentine on the top part of the detector, which was pivotal to achieve this condition. And finally, this I can skip because the details are too technical, but fine, we succeeded to stabilize also the air all around the detector. So in this moment, we have not only a detector fully decoupled, fully stabilized internally, but also the external air completely stabilized in terms of temperature. So which was the effect of this enduring effort? So we, as I said, this is an experimental effort and which was the essential prerequisite to get this CNO neutrino. So it was the core of our effort since when we embarked on the CNO quest. And the reason why we were successful is because of this persistent commitment to stabilize really was successful. And you can see that the temperature output of the probes, which are represented on the top left plot, show a stabilization over the years. This plot span 5 years, and you see the stabilization toward the end of the period. And in particular, if we take a snapshot of the last year, you see that the temperature of the several probes are very stable. Take into account that the probe resolution is 0.07 degree, so we are much more stable than the probe's resolution. So this effort, let's say, paid off and was extremely successful. But okay, this is an example, but I don't spend too many details on this technical further aspect to show that in all part of the detectors, the same type of stabilization was achieved. And from November 19, we achieved in absolute term the best temperature stability ever. Okay, so given the fact that in term of temperature itself, the probes demonstrate that the stability achieved was excellent, we can come back to our core business. So the CNO observed through the bismuth, in turn observed through the polonium. And so in order to go back to the core business, here I show a plot, a sort of bidimensional projection of the inner vessel sphere. In this bidimensional projection, what is shown is the distribution of the polonium. So this is a sort of a polonium field. So each point in the space is associated with a number, and this number is the polonium concentration in that point. So this is at any rate, this is a field, a polonium field in our liquid scintillator. And by doing this 2D projection, we understand how this field is developed in space and time, because this projection is evolving versus time. And in particular, we see that the red, the color code, which is red for the high polonium value and blue for the low polonium value, the color code demonstrates clearly how the polonium field was extremely wild varying before the insulation with high values, and instead became very quiet, very uniform, and very low after the insulation. So very wild before the insulation, very quiet after the insulation. So not only, in other words, not only we stabilize the temperature, but we stabilize the polonium, which was what we were aiming at. More importantly, we have observed that at the level of the equator, taking into account that in this 2D projection, the middle, so about 30 in this scale, is coincident with the equator of the detector. So slightly above the equator, we observe that this polonium field reaches versus time is minimum, a minimum which is rather stable in position. And this minimum has a size of about 20 ton. And this minimum value of polonium is the intrinsic polonium value that we were looking for, that we were using to, that we would like to use to infer the bismuth 210 value. This is a qualitative observation, but very importantly, is in agreement with the simulation, which corroborate this conclusion. I skip this, which is simply a three-dimensional view of the polonium field, and that the region enclosed in the grid, in the black grid, visually show the 20-ton region that we call the low part of the polonium field, where we achieve the intrinsic value of the polonium itself. Now, the simulation that I was mentioning before is this. So we have simulated with our full description of the detector. The initial hypothetical condition of Borexino at the initial of the filling, with a uniform distribution of polonium inside, and I have assumed also a surface contamination of polonium 210. Then we have run the fluid dynamical simulation, taking into account of the actual temperature distribution as measured by the probes that we have deployed to the detector. And then we end up with a distribution that shows that just above the equator, the polonium distribution field after the simulation, at the end of the simulation period, is still blue, like the initial condition. So this means that it's true that the polonium that one can get from the low polonium region, from the low polonium field, is representative of the intrinsic polonium distribution. So our qualitative observation is fully corroborated by the simulation, complete fluid dynamical simulation of the detector.
Can I ask a question, please?
Yes.
Why is it off center? It's not at the equator, but above it and not symmetrically below. Is there a reason for that?
Well, it depends from the actual distribution that we measured. And the actual distribution of the temperature depends from the full boundary condition. So it depends from the temperature on the bottom, the temperature that we have set on the top, the degree of insulation. So it is because we have that specific boundary distribution of temperatures that we get this distribution. So the fluid dynamical simulation tells that this is because of the actual temperature distribution. We could try to alter this distribution, but it's very difficult because specifically for the bottom of the detector, this is naturally determined by the rock. But the motivation is this, is because it reflects the actual temperature distribution that we know through the measurement.
I see. Thank you.
Okay, so at this point we started the analysis. So what we have done is that we worked hard on the polonium distribution versus time, and we have tracked this low polonium field in detail. So this is a sort of second order analysis. So the first order analysis is that the low polonium field is above the equator. Then we track this position versus time, and we realigned the low region to a conventional zero to take into account of a small movement. And this is partly also connected to this measure, to the question that I just received, because for an experimental test that we did at a certain point, what happened is that for few months, only for few months, the low polonium field just moved on the below the equator. Exactly the question that I received before. And this was exactly because we artificially altered for a few weeks the temperature flowing in the top serpentine. So this demonstrates again that it is because of this external boundary condition that the Lopez-Lyon field is located normally on the bottom, on the top part of the equator. In fact, when we restored the normal condition, then the Lopez-Lyon field came back to the initial position. This is shown on the top, on the bottom figures, which you see the Lopez-Lyon field mostly always on the above the equator, about 0.5, 1 meter above the equator, just dropping below when we artificially altered the top temperature. So demonstrating this clear association between the boundary temperature and the location of this field. In any case, we took into account also this temporary variation of the Lopez-Lyon field. We aligned the Polonium data to an artificial zero. This is shown on the bottom, on the top, on the top part, on the top plot. And we fitted this aligned distribution in order to extract the minimum value of the polonium in this field. In particular, we did a very simple fit of this. Essentially, this is a sort of geometrical distribution of a aligned polonium values, polonium field. We can fit it very simply with the paraboloid, and the term which is multiplicative in front of the paraboloid equation is the value of the polonium which we are interested. We can also perform a more complex fit. We did here, for example, using a spline fit with some complex nested sampling algorithm, but in any case, this was just done for a cross-check of the result. In fact, the method agreed very well with the systematics. Also, other methods were used to do the fit. And in the end, we obtained a value for the polonium, 11.5 in our unit, and our unit are conventionally count per day per 100 ton. We use this unit also for the solar neutrino flux that we detect in Bolexino, and only at the end we convert this internal experimental unit into a neutrino flux in terms of neutrino per square centimeter second. And then we have to take into account all the systematics, because what is difficult in this measurement is not so much, not only to infer the value, but mostly to infer the systematics, given the complexity of the method. So we took into, I don't enter into the detail, but we took into account all the possible systematics, so the fit method, the mass of the local onion field region, the binning or the spatial binning, the identification of the beta leak means the identification of the alpha signal, which is the polonium, with respect to the rest of the beta signal, which are the rest of the events, and then the homogeneity of the bismuth. I think that now that issues are very technical in terms of analysis, I can be a little faster, but in order to infer the final value on the bismuth from the polonium that we have just determined, we need to be sure that the Lopez-Lyon field, which is only 20 ton, is a good representative of the entire inner vessel situation of the Lewis scintill level. So we checked the bismuth uniformity, and we have assumed an energy region, which is the one around 1 MeV, essentially, in terms of absolute unit in our spectrum, in which we know that the bismuth is a sizable component, not the majority, because the majority are neutrinos, but a sizable component of our sample. And then we have performed a sort of radial plus angular analysis of this selected event. This is similar somehow to when one was to determine the uniformity of the cosmic background, for example. And then with this type of decomposition, we have demonstrated that we do not see any hint of a spatial disuniformity of a bismuth within an error which is really linked to some statistic systematic, which is less than one count, 0.78 count per day per 100 ton in our unit. And okay, here there are some details of this angular radial derivation, fundamentally one decomposes the distribution of the polonium in these two components and analyze them individually, how they deviate with respect to the uniform distribution. We do not see any real deviation. So really our data are very, very, very uniform. And in order to be sure beyond any doubt, we have also double checked this with the simulation. And also we simulated a very disuniform initial condition of Borexino at the beginning of the fill. And then we let the simulation go for more than 1 year. And we saw that even the simulation tells that if we start with a fully disuniform lead to 10, bismuth to 10 condition, that in the end, after 1 year, we are fully uniform. So this means that extrapolating our polonium to 10 to bismuth to 10 finding from this low polonium region of 20 ton to the full inner vessel is feasible. This, and we have therefore added in our error budget also this homogeneity error. And in the end, altogether, the error that we have experimentally derived, we get that the bismuth to 10 is at the level of 11.5 count plus minus an error statistic plus systematic of 1.3. And this simple number, which is, let's say, it seems a very simple number, is really what we got after 6 years of relentless effort to stabilize the detector and understand the behavior of the inner vessel. And this is the constraint which is essential to break the degeneracy with the CNO between with the bismuth in the fit. So all our, as I said at the beginning, our quest for the CNO was experimentally turned into a quest of the bismuth.
Can I ask one more question, please?
Sure.
Yeah, so the polonium itself was not uniformly distributed over the entire vessel, right? It had that little region above the equator.
Exactly.
And, yeah, but the ratio, of bismuth to polonium is extremely uniform. Is that what you are saying? Did I understand that correctly?
You understand correctly that the polonium itself is not uniformly distributed inside the vessel, but the bismuth, yes.
Okay.
So if we get the intrinsic value of the polonium, then we can extrapolate and we get the polonium intrinsic value from a small region of the vessel, then which is the actually working properly part of the vessel, then we can safely extrapolate this bismuth value in ferrite from the polonium to the whole vessel.
Oh, amazing result, actually. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
You're welcome. At this point, we can come back to our, let's say, standard fit. So the same fit that we used to extract the several PP flux can be updated by plugging inside the bismuth value as external constraint at this point. So this is the update with respect to what we published in 2018. The fact that while in 2018 the bismuth component was not known and so was practically making insensitive the fit to the CNO component, in the spectral fit of the full spectrum that we present now, we have the possibility to constrain the bismuth to this experimental determined value, and so the fit becomes sensitive to the CNO neutrinos. The fit is done with the Monte Carlo approach. It's a multivariate fit in the sense that we fit three components in reality. This is a technical aspect. Is linked. One component is the radial distribution of events. The other two components are connected to the fact that in our Lewis scintillator we have a continuous cosmogenic production of carbon 11. This is unavoidable. This is a spallation effect on carbon 12, so we have to leave it. The carbon 11 is this big bump that we see in this right spectrum. And so with a tagging procedure that we call threefold coincidence, in which we associate the initial muon, the neutrons that come out from the spallation interaction, and then the decay of the carbon 11 itself, which is a beta plus decay with a lifetime of 20 minutes, we can tag also this event. And so we have two spectra with the subtracted and tagged carbon 11 events. So we fit together this three spectrum, this multivariate fit. And what we get is a sensitivity to the CNO with a best fit that in terms of events, so in terms of our internal unit, amount to 7.2 count per day per 100 ton of liquid scintillator with an asymmetric confidence interval of minus 1.7 plus 2.9. This is because, to be conservative, we use the bismuth level inferred from the polonium, not as a measurement, but as an upper limit. And the fact that we use this constraint as an upper limit produces asymmetric confidence interval. This is, say, a conservative assumption. We could be more aggressive, consider the bismuth value as a real value. Maybe this is what we will do in the very final measurement paper that we will publish once Borexino will be completed, and we will have added almost other 2 years of data to the current data set. Then we, in order to complete our result, we have also to add the systematic effect, because the error from the fit is pure statistical. In reality, the systematic effect in our detector are very, very limited, mainly linked to some uncertainty on the energy scale, which in any case is very well known because of a careful calibration that we performed in Borexino. And so energy scale and non-uniformity of the energy and non-linearity really are all at a sub-percent level. This means that we have a final systematic of minus 0.5 plus 0.6 that when added in quadrature to the statistic error practically that almost does not change anything. And converting this final CNO result in flux of neutrinos at Earth, our measurement is 7 minus 1.9 plus 2.9 10 to 8 neutrinos per square centimeter per second. So this is our number. This is our observation of the CNO. Clearly, there is still something missing. For an observation, you need to know the significance of the observation to complete our result. And we have performed a standard likelihood ratio test following a recipe that recently has been established also for the, in this Cowan et al. Paper for the LHHC result. And we have practically performed this standard likelihood ratio test, but without resorting to asymptotic formulae, we have implemented it with straightforward brute force Monte Carlo approach. So essentially, we have generated 13 million pseudo data set of Borexino, in which we have deformed the probability density function in order to mimic this systematic effect. And we have injected no CNO in order to determine the likelihood ratio test reference distribution. And this is the gray distribution on the on the plot. The poor blue distribution would be the likelihood ratio test distribution without the systematic effect, which is slightly enlarged because of systematic effect. Then we have compared this distribution with the specific value of the likelihood ratio that stems from our data, which is the vertical black line. You see that this vertical black line practically does not intersect the Monte Carlo distribution. This means that our result is very significant. In quantitative term, it means that we have a significance greater than 5 sigma at a 99% confidence level. We have also cross-checked this with another approach by observing the log likelihood profile. And so this complete our detection in the sense that we can say that not only we observe the semi neutrinos with the value that I mentioned in the previous slide, but we observe it with a significance of 5 sigma. So no CNO hypothesis is disfavored at 5 sigma. We have also for a simply internal consistency, but we have published also this, performed a sort of simplified analysis in which we have chosen a region in our spectrum in which the signal to noise is maximized. The signal in this case are the CNO neutrinos. And this region is the yellow region in this top part. And practically what we have done is that we have counted all the events in that region, and then we have subtracted all the non-CNO components, which are known from the fit analysis. So the brilliance of neutrinos, the carbon 11. So all the other contributions which are known to exist in that region. And so by this subtraction, which is done by Monte Carlo, we are left with a residual, and this residual is the CNO neutrinos, which are not explained by all the other non-components. And we get, in this case, a signal which is compatible with the full analysis, obviously with the lower significance, in this case, 3.5 sigma. The difference is obviously clear. Multivariate fit exploits completely the information. And so this is why in this simplified analysis, the significance is lower. But it is interesting because in a very simple way, we get a consistent signal detection. And since for anything that we have done, we have always searched for an additional consistent indication. Also in this case, we thought that this was useful to demonstrate that even simple consideration show that there is a CMO component in our data. In the national paper, we have introduced this plot that summarize our finding for the CMO. In this stacked histogram, we show what I just said. If we consider the energy of interest and we put together all the non-components, mainly PP neutrino, bismuth background, and others, we have a room which is left for CNO. So this very clearly and very visually show that simply observing the signal, we have indication of the CNO. This other plot, more elaborated, indicate in the with the dot point, the likelihood profile stemming from the fit without systematics, the black solid instead the same with systematics. You see that both have a minimum around 7, so the value, the best fit value which I reported before, and the two magenta, a gray and a blue band indicate the prediction from the standard solar model. High metallicity sitting magenta, low metallicity the blue. So you see that given the large error that still we have, we can say that we are fully consistent with the expectation, even if our value is slightly higher, but we are consistent with both, even if clearly we have a slight preference for the high metallicity because our result is in the high value ballpark. And in the end, the red histogram is the output of the subtraction counting method, which is used for consistent analysis. So in the end, the message is that the enduring Borexino quest of the Sino neutrinos lasted many, many years, has finally produced the first observation of the signal in two different ways. And my conclusion is very simple. So we spent a lot of time, a lot of effort to stabilize the detector, and this has been extremely successful in allowing the first detection of a CNO neutrino ever by Borexino with a significance as high as 5 sigma. And at this point, with this outcome, Borexino alone has studied completely the sun, because we spent many years, many analysis, many results for the PP chain, and we measured all the flux of the PP chain before. Now we have also measured and observed for the first time the CNO cycle. And so we have completely unraveled both processes powering the sun. And with this, I complete. Sorry, it was a little too long, but okay, I am now at the end. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Janice. So questions, please?
May I ask? I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
So thanks for this talk. It was really a heroic effort to figure out this contamination of bismuth and take it out. Has it also helped in learning about the shape of beryllium 7 edge better, or is it not so much relevant for beryllium 7?
No, for beryllium 7, the scattering edge of beryllium 7 was not important for the CNO studies, I have to say. We, in a previous publication, we have paid a lot of attention to the shape of a beryllium 7 spectrum, but for other reasons, because, you know, it's a good probe for no standard interaction. And so we use the measure of the scattering edge of beryllium 7. We were in condition to put our own limit of non-standard interaction in the neutrino sectors. And this was a publication of a couple of years ago. But since fundamentally we do not determine any real deviation of the beryllium 7 shape from the standard expected shape, in this analysis for the CNO neutrino, we used the standard shape.
I actually have a related question because both beryllium 7 and PEP neutrinos are line spectra, but not the CNO spectra, right? They are not line spectra. So this Compton edge, though, there's a difference between the way you're going to see the electron energy distribution because of the different kinematics between the two. So how sensitive is your result to the uncertainties in the cross sections, because they are going to be different, because the kinematics between the line spectra and the non-line spectra should make a difference between the two, right?
Yes, in fact. Okay, let me.
I mean, in other words, this 1 MeV energy region, how well do you know these cross sections? I mean.
Okay, the cross-section per se, since our scattering cross-section are very well known. So this is, there is no uncertainty associated, it's very limited because it's simply the scattering cross-section on neutrino, on electrons. So on this, there is no doubt, no uncertainty. There is a difference that you correctly pointed out, in the sense that Unfortunately, I cannot go back. Okay, now it's. Okay. The prediction, in fact, are very accurate because the scattering mechanism of the cross-section is very well described and modeled, so there is an answer to it. But there is a difference experimentally. Since beryllium 7 and PAP are line, then the resulting scattering spectrum has this very characteristic Compton-like edge. And this is extremely helpful to pinpoint that component in the fit. So you see that there is a beryllium 7 in the spectrum is immediately visible because I see the shoulder in my spectrum. For the PAP, it is the same. I have not the measurement, but we have published on the Nexon 2 PA of 2018 that we see very clearly. You can see an hint here on the log scale, but in a linear scale is very clear. In our spectra, we see also the scattering edge of a PAP. All the difficulty connected to the detection of a CNO neutrino is because there is no such a feature. I have no point of the spectrum to anchor my analysis. So I have to do really a signal to noise analysis alone. So I have to fight as much as possible the background. There is a possibility that I know will be exploited in the future by other larger experiment, which is the following. You have to take into account that Voreksino in modern term has now become a small experiment, and in modern term, he has not the best possible resolution. So you see that if I accumulate a very high statistics, and if my resolution is very good, in principle, I have the last part of the CNO spectrum between 1.2 and 1.5, which is beyond, which is above the spectrum, the background spectrum of the bismuth. So if I had available a perfect spectrometer with infinite resolution and with large mass, I could try to do spectroscopy of CNO only on this tail, on the tail above 1.2. And I could, even if it is not a Compton-like scattering edge, I could try to recognize with a perfect resolution this part of the spectrum. This can be done by future experiment. For example, I know that the Snow Plus experiment, which is just now being filled, since the Snow Plus experiment in principle could have a resolution better than Voreksino, then they could try to do this. Clearly, they have to reach the Voreksino grade in terms of purity. So the difficulty that you pinpoint clearly is the fact that the CNO spectrum being not a line has not a signature. The fact that it has not signature forced us to do a brute force quest. The brute force quest means suppress and understand the background as much as possible. And this is why we had to work 6 years, not directly to observe the CNO, but to understand perfectly the bismuth 210 background. Once we solve this, the problem associated with the featureless CNO spectrum does not exist anymore. I hope to have been clear, but clearly this is the core of the detection. This is exactly the difficulty of the detection of the CNO and why we had to work so much to get it.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Further questions? So I had a quick question from a non-expert. So when you say the PEP contribution was left free, do you mean to say that the overall scale was left as a parameter, but the shape is given by maybe the cross sections and what we know about the sun, or there was more freedom in the spectrum choice for PEP?
No. The shape is stemming from standard physics.
Okay.
So is the normalization that is a matter of choice, but the shape is in all these cases, all the PDF that are used for the fit, the shape is stemming from standard physics. So the physics of the sun and the physics of the detection inside the detector.
So do you have an unofficial estimate for the oscillation parameters? What is the percentage of events you are seeing compared to the expected?
Ah, okay, yes. For you mean the expected without the oscillation?
Yes.
Okay, for the CNO, I don't remember by heart the number. For the beryllium 7, for example, we have we detect 45 events instead with the oscillation would be 70.
Yes.
For CNO we detect 7 and with oscillation, without the oscillation they would be about 15, 16, something like that. What I show at the very end in the last picture was the comparison with the prediction, but with the oscillation. So if I come back to the last picture, when these two bands, the blue and magenta line band are what is predicted in our detector, but considering the oscillation. So for example, take into account the standard solar model and the physics in the detector, theoretically, one should expect 5 counts in our detector, but take into account already of the oscillation in the case of high metallicity and 3.5 in the case of low metallicity. Instead, we observe the actual number, which clearly is oscillated because this is the actual number, is about 7. If you want on this same scale, the prediction with the oscillation will be above 14, something like that, without the oscillation.
I see. So there will be no sensitivity to the difference between the fraction of oscillated events for the 7 beryllium and the PEP, would you be able to tell if, because they are slightly different in energy, you see the okay. 7 beryllium is at the slightly lower energy and that's where you have a interest in the shape of the oscillation curve, no? Because it goes from high value at PP to a low value at the
Okay, if you want I can share, sorry, 1 minute, I share this. The plot that you are asking me, which is not in this presentation.
Great.
I can try to find the right presentation. Sorry.
Yeah, actually, if it's unofficial and you want me to stop the recording, please let me know.
No, no problem.
Okay.
The only problem is that I have changed my computer. I don't have this slide at end because I changed my computer. In any case, what we did, what was trying to show, was exactly what you asked. So we for each component of a PPE chain, we performed the comparison of the survival probability, so the oscillation probability stemming from our data, and that stemming from the model. And clearly we see that there is a variation following the energy. And so for example, for what concern beryllium 7, it is slightly higher, this slightly lower, sorry, the oscillation probability with respect to the PP. So we see the profile of the oscillation following the energy. For example, the difference is very great between the beryllium 7 and the boron 8. So we see what you say. Clearly, we can see very clearly the difference between beryllium 7 and boron 8 oscillation probability. Between the PP and the PAP also can be appreciated. Between beryllium 7 and PAP, well, the error band is such that we cannot see the difference. But the general behavior, yes, we see the general behavior of the expected membrane oscillation probability as a function of energy. And this is an important outcome. This is obviously not linked to the CNO, but this is an important outcome because it's a demonstration by Borexino alone that actually the neutrino oscillation probability is a function of energy. So it's different as the neutrino energy.
I see. Thank you.
I cannot show you the plot because I changed the computer.
Well, if you can actually send it to the host, you know, your PDF file, I would be very appreciative. If you can, I mean, send a copy.
Yeah, I can put it on the Indigo webpage. And
That would be very nice. Thank you very much.
Okay. If there are no further questions, are there any other questions? If not, then thanks to the speaker once again. And hopefully you'll come to India soon and we'll have you in person.
I would like, I would be delighted. Very good, thank you a lot for this nice invitation. It was a pleasure for me to discuss the Borexino results with you. And surely I take this invitation, and if when it will be possible, I will come very, very happy to come to India.
Okay.
It was a wonderful achievement. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah.